What is up, everybody? Hump day.
Hump day.
Tonight, on our phenomenal show, The Breakdown, we are going to be going through another interesting list, because it was a pain in the ass to write.
Yeah, it was.
20 songs of from bands that we were not expecting on that CD. So I didn't really write down the CD names, which I probably should have. You know, I'm the one that came up with it. Now I just thought, like, that was a mistake.
And we decided we could double dip with bands, but not from the same albums.
Exactly. So that way
makes perfect sense.
We're going to have different pools here, so that way we're spreading the love.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. But before we get into it, I'm gonna run a quick word from our sponsor over at how about we go to Deadly Grounds Coffee?
I think you need to wake up. You need some coffee. That sounds
good. I've got some. I need to drink it.
Yep.
Everyone thinks because you're a zombie, you don't know good coffee. Well, they're wrong. There's only one brew that gets my seal of approval. Deadly Grounds Coffee is my guilty pleasure. The aroma is so intoxicating. It brings all of my neighbors out of the woodwork. Deadly Grounds Coffee. Coffee to die for and zombie approved. It's good to get a little deadly.
Use the front door!
Oh, they're so disgusting.
All right, that is Deadly Grounds. There is a Scoops and Mischief Raspberry Mocha Carnival Dreams. Looks like that. And there is also a Hellflyer Devil's Chocolate. Also very good. What the hell are you doing?
You know, that's my favorite.
Oh, yeah.
It's just so tasty, I can't help but to lick the packaging. I'm sorry.
I mean, yeah, that's fair. That is totally fair.
When it's right
or
there
extremely
next to me.
Hard up or both. I don't know.
That's what she said?
Right.
All right, gentlemen, who would like to go first tonight? I know we did last time, I believe.
I mean, I'm good with whichever. I can go.
Sure.
So, you know, for me, growing up being an Ozzy Osbourne fan, you know, especially from Sabbath and then hearing a solo record for the very first time, a song that I just was not expecting in any shape or form, was Goodbye to Romance.
Love that.
Had to be, in my opinion, one of the most beautiful songs that I've ever heard Ozzy sing. Mm-hmm. You know, almost kind of like, you know, hit you in the feels a little bit.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So I'll go with that on my first.
All right. Really, is it my turn or your turn?
Well, let's go clockwise. So that's fine.
Okay. I will stick with Ozzy, and I am going with Mama, I'm Coming Home.
Nice. Tonight we're having some technical difficulties, so Reaper's going to be popping in and out a little bit.
Oh,
so
son of a... Again?
Yeah, and then in your laugh, you're... Yeah. Well, that's fine. If we're going to be on the Ozzy train, you know, then we definitely got to keep that going. So most I'm going to say... I'm going to say Dreamer from Ozzy. That was his way of paying homage to John Lennon for Imagine. That was his version, so fucking love that.
Okay, cool.
So I'm going to have to follow that up with a Sabbath classic. As we know that Black Sabbath is, you know, the be-all, end-all of heavy music from the very start. And a little song called Changes suddenly comes out. And, I mean, after anthems like Iron Man, Paranoid, Electric Funeral, the entire fucking first record, you get Changes. Holy shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I try to stay away from your list, damn it.
I'm sorry. Did I get one?
Oh, you're good, buddy.
All right. I actually did not put any Sabbath on here, but that's all right. I am going to go with Desperado by Alice Cooper from his Killer album.
I like that.
Hell yeah.
I'm going to go ahead and go to The Gift from A Dozen Furies. Like, the way that the album starts off with is just... People don't know that band, sadly. They were phenomenal. They won MTV's little show they did for Ozfest. Mm-hmm. They're really killer. But The Gift is the way that the album started off. And you're just like, okay, what am I going into? And then immediately track two, heavy guitar. And you're just like, this is what we're going in. All right. Like, yeah. So even though it's not like in the middle aspect, I like that that's how you enter into it.
All right.
Hell yeah. I mean, that's a great way to kick off a record. I'm going to go with one of my all-time favorite greats. Unfortunately, Lemmy, wherever you are, you're still kicking ass, brother. Anyway, I got to go with the song Love Me Forever.
Mm-hmm.
When you think of Motorhead, you think of like just like almost like biker rock, you know, lots of blues and hard, fast kind. Sometimes a little bit thrashing, you know, and that song just it's amazing. Him as a lyricist, you know what I mean? Even more so than you know his bass playing. So had to put it on there.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Lemmy's, that's a good Lemmy's not dead, man. His spirit's still alive.
Oh yeah, hardcore.
Damn straight. Don't you forget it.
Oh, yeah. My next one is going to be Roulette by System of a Down. That one totally blew me away. I mean, it's so, like, soft and sweet. And it comes off of the friggin' Toxicity album. And everyone knows that album. It's like, whoa, okay.
Yeah. Well, I like where you're at with that. So I'm going to piggyback and go along with, I'm going to say, System of a Down's Lonely Day. Completely different drive what you're used to, not as heavy, and fucking right there is a very sad, you know, emotional song.
Oh, absolutely. So I'm gonna take it back a little bit to Danzig's second album, Lucifuge. Blood and Tears is by far one of the most dark, romantic blues tunes by, you know, the fucking devil himself there, just belting it out with so much emotion. And, you know, he's just obviously very much in love with the person he's singing this for. So, I mean, it just fucking, you know, you're out with your girl. You put that song on, you're guaranteed to get some. If you haven't heard it, check it out.
All right. My next one is going to be Don't Know What You Got Till It's Gone by Cinderella.
I like it.
All right.
I'm going to have to go with A Warm Place by Nine Inch Nails. Hearing that for the first time on, which is by far one of my all-time favorite songs, of Downward Spiral. Now, yes, Trent Reznor's known for putting an instrumental song on every CD and all that, but just the way that it shifts from everything being so heavy, machinery, and just in your face, to drop that down to calm, soothing, you know, it just... complete flip of what you've listened to the entire time to that album.
Absolutely. And speaking of, you know, some artists that you just wouldn't normally get this kind of a song from, and it just ends up blowing you away, especially as dark as the one as I'm about to say. Mm-hmm. I have to go with Marilyn Manson's Kill For Me. It is such a hot song, and it's so poppy, which is not what we're used to from him.
No, not at all.
But there was, like, just enough element there to, like, let you know that, yeah, he's still the fucking, you know, evil mastermind. But, I mean, it's just a hot fucking love song. Hot fucking love song.
You going to piggyback on that, Eryk?
I am totally piggyback on that. I'm going a whole different direction with it, though, and I'm going with off his most recent album, We Are Chaos. That song, a lot of people get a lot of hate. I enjoyed it personally, but it's just so like, it's
all that one's off the new record.
It's like very upbeat and happy sounding.
Like, very.
What the hell?
Which is not normal.
When I first heard it on the radio, I was like, what the fuck is this?
Like, right.
Well, then if we're going to stick around with the Eminem section, we're going to go ahead with The Man That You Fear.
Mm. That's a good one.
Yes. Ah, definitely one of those tunes that kind of came out of nowhere. And you couldn't help but feel emotion and be like fucking scared at the same time. So, you know, it was definitely caught you in the feels there.
Especially the video. When they put that out on MTV.
Oh, the video was powerful. Fucking powerful.
Yeah.
Like, took you back to the time of the Salem witch trials when you got fucking stoned.
Mm-hmm. And not the good stone, folks.
No, not the good stone.
No. No. Definitely not. Speaking of, since we're in the realm of the underworld darkness, this next artist is actually now a little bit more famous for doing some of these, like, gorgeous fucking songs. Even though they're dark, some of them are very pretty and quite melodic. And I'm talking about Rammstein, and I'm going with Zayman.
Absolutely. And I'm going to piggyback right off of that. And I'm going with Sturbnik Vermeer off of the Rosenroth album. The whole album itself was a lot, you know, quite a bit more melodic than their other ones. That song in particular, duet between Till and that lady, and it's gorgeous.
I thought we'd be a little heavy on that, so I actually stayed away from Rammstein on this one, sadly. Even though one of my favorite pieces actually has no lyrics from them, it's a reimagined version, but I'm still going to go ahead and... Mm. So, with going with reimagined virgins.
we hungry tonight. Hellflyer.
The peanut butter fluff did its job, but I'm mistaken because I didn't have milk with it, so it's a little thick. So I'm not saying the things properly. Do not eat peanut butter and fluff before the show, folks.
I guess not.
So I'm going to go with Falling in Reverse is the drug in me is, but it's reimagined because of the way that it builds up and changes from the way that the normal of the song is supposed to be. It's more upbeat and poppy and good to go. This one, just simple piano. And as the song progresses, it gets harder and, you know, more harsh in your face and everything else. So hell yeah. Something completely different from what the original song was supposed to be and what their normal music is.
Very much. I'm going to go with another one of my personal favorites. I'm talking about the guys from the Bronx. Peter Still is still with us, of course. Typo Negative and Christian Woman. Just a song that I wasn't expecting. And there's such a pretty acoustic breakdown towards the end of the song. It's a very long song.
Oh, definitely.
But just amazing harmonies in the vocals, and I just fucking loved it.
All right. I'm going to piggyback off of that, and I'm going to go with Summer Breeze and Set Me on Fire by Typo.
Yes.
I love those two.
One of the most underrated covers of all time.
Agreed.
All right. Well, I'm going to jump over to Korn. So, you know, Dead, a very short but different aspect. Again, taking a completely different turn from what you're normally hearing from them.
All right.
Absolutely. Checking my list here. Hold on a second.
He actually has a list tonight, folks. Wow.
Oh, I do. You know, because y'all just think I make this shit up on the spot. So we are used to hearing The Cure. You know, in a much more kind of like a more alternative rock kind of, you know, a way. And I know I've had this song on one of my lists before, but I kind of thought it was appropriate as a song that you're just not thinking you would get from an artist that you love.
Right.
So I've got to go with their song Burn off the Crow soundtrack. That was like The Cure on fucking crack. You know, just was not expecting that at all. And it's so good. I still listen to it to this day. I mean, we're talking 30 fucking years later.
Oof. I was just listening to that song last night. I mean, that's because I was watching the movie. That's beside the point.
It's one of those bands that's in a rotation for me. So I completely understand.
Definitely.
Yes.
I'm going to piggyback off of Hellflyer and go with another song by Korn. I'm going with, there's this weird 1 minute little ditty on their Issues album called For You, which I don't know where the hell that one came from, but it was cool. It just sounded very different.
And on that was actually Jonathan Davis's deceased wife, sadly, was her favorite song.
Really?
Yeah. So even again, something short and everything else, that was one of the things that I wanted to learn to play. It's so simple, but to play on drums is, I don't know, the simplest fucking thing. But yeah, so
hey, sometimes simple hits you harder.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Hello, John.
So I'm gonna go ahead and keep going with Korn. Okay. This other one with Tearjerker. Again, something that stood out.
Nice.
Completely different from the normal album.
Definitely.
And song's got a hell of a lot of meaning, and I gotta say, I stuck with it after one breakup. It was pretty fucking terrible, but I was like, Korn helped me through it.
I'm totally gonna piggyback off of you on this one. That was a great example, and Jonathan Davis as a vocalist, just in general, it doesn't matter what he sings, what form a band he's in, it's always something new, something different. And just, you get this dimensions to his vocal ability. So I got to go with one of my, you know, this movie got a lot of fucking hate, not going to lie. But God damn it, I love the Queen of the Damned, and every song that he wrote for that movie was so fucking amazingly different. It's like, Corn who?
Right. You know? At that point in time, after listening to that, he stood out more. So absolutely.
Yeah. It was just a wonderful, tasty surprise.
Agreed.
That one's kind of loaded. It's more than one, but hey, they were all fucking fantastic.
Just to go really quick, he actually went on tour later on playing those songs, and he was like in a cool.
Oh, I would have fucking died.
It's on YouTube, actually. So it's a
phenomenal. I'm gonna have to watch it.
Yeah, he's done like an AOL special where he's done those separately, but then he did a tour section, which is fucking phenomenal. I'll share it with you guys later.
Right. That's all right. Badass.
My next one, I don't think I actually put it on any of their albums, but Ghost did some acoustic work, and when they did a version of their version of the song, If You Have Ghosts, acoustically, I could not believe it. I mean, it absolutely gorgeous.
Speaking about gorgeous, what's a list without one of our favorite singers? So I'm gonna bring up Evanescence because we always have to have her on our list. For My Immortal, again, complete different change. Not used to hearing something like that. Just more soft tone, brings a little tear to your eye. Fucking love it.
Definitely.
Fuck yeah. Okay, all right, so let me go back to my list here. God damn it. Actually, I was going to piggyback off of Eryk a little bit. So Ghost, you know, everyone prior to that, all those big, heavy, hard-hitting albums that we love so much, they're known for a ton of awesome melodicism and their musicality. And their style is very today. I mean, it's got some flavors from the past, but I was not expecting them to go back to the 60s the way they did with their song Kiss the Goat.
Yeah.
Probably one of my all-time favorite fucking Ghost songs because it was so fun. It was like Jim Morrison fucking standing on the satanic pulpit just fucking, you know, kiss the goat, baby. Come on. You know, made you want to kiss.
Kiss the goat. Wow. So good. I love it.
I mean, it was just a fun track.
I see Eryk is hot tomorrow with the goats doing that.
I did film a TikTok.
Buying Eryk a goat.
All right, my next one I'm going with is Snuff by Slipknot.
All right.
There's a lot of good ones from Slipknot that just stand. Like, well, since Reaper stole one of my other ones, I'll just throw this in.
I didn't mean to.
No, you did the Black Sabbath changes. That's fine. So I'm just trying to, like, fill it out a little bit more. So for me, though, I'm going to put Slipknot's Vermillion Part 2. That whole CD, in theory, for everything, like, there was no cussing in that. Like, that, I remember when that CD actually came out, a little fun fact for you, I went to four different record places, even Best Buy, and trying to find, like, a parental advisory one. And there was nowhere to be found. I'm like, what the hell? And then come to find out years later, Corey Taylor's like, they were critiquing everything that we're doing and going, you can't even write a song without a curse word. And he goes, we did the whole fucking album that way. Like, there is no parental advisory at all on that complete album. He's like, this is a different take and everything else. So I can't put the whole album, but I'll definitely put down, you know, Vermillion Part 2 was, that was not something anybody was expecting from Slipknot alone.
All right.
All right. So for me... okay, so first of all, it's hard to imagine this next artist to be playing any other type of music other than what he's been known for 30 fucking years and still going strong. Of course, I'm talking about Behemoth. I'll probably be piggybacking off of this, but he went on to, like, in a short break, you know, from Behemoth, he started his own side project. It is literally nothing like you would ever expect this man to do. Clean singing with kind of like a satanic version of Elvis Presley in a way, like only to the umpth degree. It's all acoustic guitar. You got harmonica, you know, just regular, you know, drum beats, no blast beats or nothing. I'm talking about Me and That Man. Almost like an evil, like Neil Young type song, which I don't know, I just find so attractive. The song is called Of Sirens, Vampires, and Lovers. If you haven't checked it out, it is fucking Sex on Wheels. I mean,
I like that. I'm going to use that terminology here in a second, so that's perfect.
All right. My next one I'm going with. So, you know, everyone knows Twisted Sister. Then, you know, we're not going to take it. And I want to rock. There's this other song on that same album called The Price, which is like miles away from those other songs.
Can I also add to that as well? I'm sorry. I'm adding a lot tonight. But Twisted Sister's Christmas album is phenomenal.
I adore that album. So
the way that they took their original songs and made it Christmas is fucking great.
Instant classic.
It is. Especially their 12 Days of Christmas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right.
It's like 4 quarts of Jack, 3 stolen belts, and a tattoo of Ozzy or something.
Yeah. Great.
Before you move on, if I may interject with a quick commercial.
By all means.
All right.
I do believe you are allowed. Word.
Okay, okay. Quick word from our sponsor over at Villain Arts. That's Villain Arts. They do events all across the country with some of the artists from the show Ink Master and Scoops and Mischief sometimes go. If they're in the area, make sure you check that shit out.
Yeah. Fucking first. Fucking.
Okay. The way you froze Reaper was fucking.
God damn it. I said fucking phenomenal.
Yes.
Shit. All right, Flyer.
So, like Reaper said, it's Sex on Wheels, and this literally is Sex on Wheels. We're going to go with the very long but quite enjoyable song of Meatloaf, Paradise by the Dash.
That
song
better than that.
Literally in the vehicle, about to get it on. So that is Sex on Wheels. That was my shoo-in, because the replacement for Black Sabbath.
All right.
I shall piggyback yet again.
Do it. I got a strong back.
I kind of figured that, you know, we would touch upon the wonderful 70s. This one has become probably one of the most iconic cult classic musicals of all time. And, of course, I am talking about The Time Warp, Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, yeah.
Probably one of the, I mean, I could have never imagined such a song. So fun, so cool, but dark as fuck at the same time. Yeah. Oh, man. Definitely set a tone for a lot of shit to come in, you know, the coming years. So,
yes.
Still relevant, still love it, still get down to it.
Absolutely. The next one I'm going to go with is Beyond the Realm of Death by Judas Priest.
'Tis a good one, sir.
It is.
Indeed.
I'm going to go with Fiddle and the Drum from A Perfect Circle. The vocal technique of Maynard and everything, just for the simple thing of that, is just so, again, delicate, lovely, and again, not what you're used to hearing on the normal basis.
Mm-hmm. All right. Kind of like from the same era that Eryk was in just a few moments ago. We know this vocalist, you know, as the front man of one of the greatest power metal bands of all time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the career has spanned 50 years almost, and still going, no signs of slowing down. But Bruce Dickinson from Iron Maiden stepped out on his own for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
And gave us a mind-blowing cover of All the Young Dudes.
Yeah.
You know, that you just wouldn't have expected him to do. You know, he's talking about all kinds of shit from, you know, ancient wars and, you know, almost like some Dungeons and Dragons shit. And there he comes out with this cover that it's like, holy shit, there's a whole nother side to this guy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. My next one I'm going with, speaking of things, people with long careers and things that you did not see coming, I'm going to go with Boom 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 by Rob Zombie off of the Lunar Injection Kool-Aid Eclipse Conspiracy.
Ah, yes.
I love how that just rolls right off your tongue.
It wasn't an event. I have it written in front of me. That song just has such a different feel from the rest of that album, and a
lot of depth.
Oh, for sure. It's honestly, that's probably my favorite track on that one. It's just so cool. I love it.
I'm gonna go in the 90s here, and we're gonna go to The Meadow by Head PE. After hearing Bartender and a bunch of other stuff from them, and then going to that, complete difference. And it's one of my go-tos to actually sing when I'm bored.
Okay.
Hell yeah. I've actually had the pleasure of playing with Head PE more than one occasion. Great bunch of fellas.
Mm-hmm.
Partied till we dropped. It was great.
Lucky.
I know.
I don't care about the party. I just want to hang out.
Right. Exactly. So, going way out of the realm of where we've been hanging out. So one of my favorite guilty pleasures that basically started from the 80s, it's very electronic, not industrial per se, but I mean, it's just great electronica. At least that's what I call it. Very, you know, goth, very big in the goth scene, always will be. One of my favorite groups of all time is Depeche Mode. And when they did this one album, and they used live instrumentation versus what their fans have always known.
Mm-hmm.
And the front man grew his hair long and black, and a nice, you know, black beard. And they hit you with the first single off there called I Feel You. This fucking bluesy 12-8. Mm-hmm. Fucking melt you to your core, you know, pitching fucking tents every time you walk. What a great fucking song. You know, and I just have so much respect for them because I'm like, yeah, they just showed the world that they are very excellent musicians.
Mm-hmm.
Whether they're using electronics or they're using acoustic, you know. So, had to do it.
Okay. My next one is going to be, okay, let's go with, When the Wild Wind Blows by Iron Maiden.
Nice.
I love all the different varieties of music. I love these parts of our show. It's just, it's all over and it's phenomenal.
It's like a wealth, you know?
Yes. I'm going to go back cause I'm a huge Nine Inch Nails fan, but, after watching a certain movie and hearing Something I Can Never Have, again, shifting completely different, not the same tone, just fucking, oh, I don't know. Sometimes the softer shit just really fucking speaks to me more than the heavier. And I'm like, I love the heavy, but when it gets to that, it's just like, now you're really speaking to me. All right, you got my attention. And I love Natural Born Killers. And then hearing that in there, just fucking love. I bought the soundtrack for that one of that reasons, because it's a different variation of the song compared to what's on the normal CD.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Poor Reaper's frozen again.
Wait, am I?
Yeah, we can hear you, but you're frozen. There you are.
Okay. Sorry.
Laugh out of nowhere. Complete silence, then laugh.
Ah, because you didn't fucking see what I did. That's why. But anyway, so, you know, I had mentioned these guys a little bit before, but did not choose one of their songs. The latest release by Behemoth from the album I Loved You at Your Darkest, they received critical acclaim because they showed that there was more to them than just fucking black metal. Mm-hmm. And one of their biggest singles was not a heavy track at all. Mm. But it just is powerful. And I'm talking about the single Bartzabel. It's just very backbeat. Boom, tap, goom, goom, tap, goom, goom. They're like, man, never thought that their drummer could place just a real nice in the pocket groove versus all the, you know, fucking double bass and blast beats galore. And they, all of them, the backing vocals, their harmonies, it was just like, holy shit. It's still dark as fuck, but damn. Mm-hmm. Makes you fall in love with it.
All right. I'm going to go back in time about 20-25 minutes and go back to Rammstein. Mm-hmm. And I'm going with Rotor Sound off of their Liebe ist für Alida album.
Oh, yes. Probably one of their best albums, in my opinion.
Oh, I feel like hardly anyone talks about that album anymore, and that's one of their, definitely one of their best. But that song in particular, I mean, that vocal performance is stellar.
Big time.
Okay. I'm going to go with Line in the Sand by Bleeding Through.
Ooh, that's a good one. I don't
know that one.
You don't know that one?
I'm familiar with it. I am.
Oh, yeah. No, but Eryk was saying he doesn't know that. You've got to check it out.
Okay, I will.
Yes. Again, some of those soft things is just, I love, you know, screaming in music. I love listening to all that. And yes, I can understand the words. And then when you drop it down and you softly sing to me, you're just melting my heart. And then it's just the complete, like, tempo change, softness. It's like, all right, I'm sold. You got me. Mm-hmm. Just fucking listening to that entire album was fucking amazing.
Okay, so I got to throw another monkey wrench in there. awesome choice. But for me, one of the ones that I had to bring up is a song that with this next band who started in the late 70s, and obviously their biggest fame was in the 80s. And we were at the pretty much the beginnings of the MTV world that, you know, took us by storm. So you were able to see videos, you know, for a lot of your favorite bands. The band that I'm talking about is Journey. And the reason I'm putting it on here is because you would not expect a hard-hitting, heavy track coming out of them. And I'm talking about Separate Ways. Mm. It's like as soon as the keyboards hit, and then you get this bone crunching riff. I'm just like, whoa, what the fuck? Just a few minutes ago, you were just touching, fucking squeezing and shit. Now you're like, you couldn't help but get excited about it. And it was just a very hard hitting track. And it
sometimes
was
like, you gotta awesome. Bang after you're squeezing and touching.
All All right, I am going to... This one's a bit different than the other stuff on my list, but that's okay. Everyone remembers that song from Dusk Till Dawn, the song After Dark by Tito and Tarantula.
Mm-hmm.
On the same album is this really... Not that soundtrack off their Tarantism album. There's a song called Flying in My Sleep. Which...
Gotcha.
I mean... If you haven't heard it, you need to go check it out. You know what I mean?
Oh, fuck. Most definitely. How could you not?
It's like this gorgeous lullaby.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to go next with In Between from Linkin Park.
Ooh, yes.
There were so many good songs on Menace to Midnight, but that was just one of those ones, again, you weren't expecting, you know, especially with... you know, being one singer where it's just more softer than you're used to. And it's like, this is not a rap. This is not your MO, but you're again, singing Sweet Nothings to my ear.
Yeah.
So I know this, you know, this one particular band has lost a little bit of credibility over the years, but at the height of their career, their popularity, Godsmack was once a very, you know, very good band. With a hey, lot of good songs.
Agreed.
Say what now?
They still are, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, and to most people that have always been diehards, but, you know, a lot of people, you know, because, you know, Sully changed his tune a little bit, they just kind of, you know, wasn't really about it anymore, so sadly. But, hey, it happens. But the fact is, they gave us a fucking track that is still widely played today. Great meditation song, fucking voodoo.
I knew you were going there. As soon as you said Godsmack, I'm like, oh, I forgot to put that on there. But I'm glad you covered
it. Brother picked it up.
Yeah, I'm glad you covered that.
All right. My next one, I am going with the band Avatar and the song Tower off of Hail the Apocalypse.
Okay.
That song is, nice. I mean, that album is so friggin' heavy. And then we have this song where he just straight up clean vocals, stay inside and dream of towers. It's like, what the fuck?
All right. I'm going to go with, see, it's hard to like bring up Mudvayne and be like, what? Like their stuff's heavy. Their stuff's there. But Poop Loser was like a weird transition for them. Just in the different aspect of it, and like the babies crying, and you're just like, what the fuck am I listening to? But I just remember playing that. I was like, this is a weird ass track. Like, it's not something I would expect again from the band.
Nice.
See, I told you, Reaper, it's not all ballads.
It's all good. It's all good. So, obviously, this particular single was probably the biggest single. That this particular band has had in the last five years or so. And nobody in the fucking face of the planet would have expected them to cover a Simon and Garfunkel song.
Oh, yeah.
Mr. himself from fucking Disturbed and The Sound of Silence.
Agreed.
Agreed. So many people hated this cover, and it's
which is beautiful. Fucking crazy to me. And I think a lot of people, like, if you go back and listen to the actual original, which I have, I've known it actually for a long time, always thought it was a great song, but there was a lot of, like, live instrumentation. Mm-hmm. You had drums going, you had guitar going, bass going. So, but the way he did it was so fucking creepier.
Right.
That's what I loved about it the most.
Yeah.
You know, that they were able to kind of bastardize a very lighthearted fucking song, you know, from that era.
And his vocal tone in just the whole song, the way that it, you know, increases and everything else from how deep it is to that, and just brings light to it. I mean, it goes from a very dark spot to a very uplifting different thing. So absolutely. I didn't feel like I should put that on there, but I was like, it's close, but thank you, Reaper. I appreciate you because what I'm missing, you're picking up and putting down.
Agreed. He picks things up and puts them down.
Exactly.
Fuck yeah. Right.
Well, mm-hmm. It wouldn't be an episode of The Breakdown unless I bring up Moonspell.
we already knew that was coming.
I've got a double shot of Moonspell, but the first one I'm going with is All or Nothing off of their new album, Hermitage. This song, I don't think I ever saw it coming. It's mostly acoustic. It's like a love letter and almost like a almost a goodbye to fans because they're thinking about starting to retire the next 5 years or so.
Right. And
it's just such a different song than the usual sound.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. And I can remember, I believe you played it for me.
I did.
And I was just like,
they're playing it in that like cathedral or whatever.
Yeah. And it was just, it was still fucking bad fucking ass, though, too.
Sure.
You know, but you could definitely tell that they were, you know, reaching their end, so to speak, because the sound had matured so much. Mm-hmm. And just kind of like backed off, but the vocals were still strong as shit. So, yeah, great fucking song. Sure. I dug it.
Yeah, I was excited to hear that he was putting actually a blue Moonspell song on here. I was like, okay, good. I'm glad that this is all still being accepted. Except when I thought of the idea, I'm like, how are we going to still put Typo on here and Moonspell? You know, Rammstein's going to be slid in there anyway, so that's fine. But I was like, I need to make it a little bit harder next time.
Hey, it doesn't matter what topic is. I am going to relate it to Moonspell somehow.
Good point. So what?
Oh, sorry. I thought it was my time to go. Am I right?
No.
Fuck. I was about to jump.
I can let you.
I jumped.
I'm actually going to go with DBL from A Perfect Circle.
Right.
Again, just different things. I don't know, the tone and effort from Maynard again, and just the different aspects. There's not much I could say really about the song without someone actually going to it and listening to it and actually hearing what I'm thinking. It's going to be very difficult, but again, stands out from their normal, MO.
Oh, without a doubt. So, this next band, one of the greatest metal bands of all time. Hands down, rooted in thrash, gave us some of the greatest heavy songs ever. Now, consequently, after the Black Album, all of us original folks just kind of said, go fuck yourself.
They pulled you back with St. Anger.
Never poking a smile.
Come on. They pulled you back with St. Anger. I know it's true.
Oh, no. I am cursed with the sound of that snare drop. Even that was better. But you can't fucking deny the amazing song, actually more than one on that record, which I may reference another one, but the one that I'm talking about is something we just never thought you'd hear come out of James's mouth. And it's actually one of the first times we get to see him do a fucking guitar solo. The guy's fucking skilled as shit. Not to mention singing over top those riffs. Holy fuck. Anyway, When Nothing Else Matters came out.
Yes.
I was just like, I watched it. I listened to it probably a couple hundred times. I was just like, damn, it's just so heartfelt, you know? Just kind of like takes you back to like a simpler time when you're just fucking with your buddies and, just enjoying good times and stuff like that. So, yep.
Yeah.
Had to put it on there.
Good choice.
All right. That was definitely a good choice.
How many do we got left, Eryk?
I've got one more.
Okay.
That's after y'all stole a couple of mine, but yeah, I've got one more.
I'm sorry, buddy.
Oh, that's okay. So, the last one on my list is, again, I have Moonspell. But this is this beautiful instrumental piece off of their first album. Their first album, very dark, very like black metal-esque. And yet, right in the middle, there is this like, it's a like keyboards that sound like a flute and an acoustic guitar line. And it's called Lua de Inverno, which means Moon of Autumn. And it is the most gorgeous thing.
Love that title.
like ever. And I don't know what the hell where that came from. I love it.
I like it. Well, I'll just go. I was thinking about putting a Tool song on here that would be in German because it was completely different from what they're normally doing, especially when they're telling you how to make, you know, cookies with no egg. But I was like, you know, I got two Perfect Circle songs on here. I'll leave Maynard alone for a little bit. So I'm going to go with this version. It's a cover. But Behind Blue Eyes by Limp Bizkit. I was not expecting... was not expecting like that version coming out from them, and it was like, all right, like, cool. I'm really digging the shit out of this.
Yeah.
Abso-fucking-lutely. So I'm gonna step out of the metal genre for just a moment. Gonna kind of go into the mainstream a little bit, with kind of like the resurgence of punk. In the early 2000s, we were kind of taken by storm by groups like Rancid, and Social D was still kicking fucking ass, and, you know, all of them, Murphy's Law and all that shit. But the most popular one prior to, like, Blink 182, like, really kind of stealing the thunder, Green Day, which is still another fucking favorite of mine. They're known for fast, hard-hitting lyrics. Just so much fucking fun. You just, you know, the whole fucking time. And then Boulevard of Fucking Dreams comes out of nowhere and just steals your soul.
I'm shocked you went that way. I thought you were going for something else.
No. I don't know. Boulevard of Broken Dreams is just kind of like a, just a, I don't know. It was a little bit more personal for me, I guess, when I heard it.
Yeah.
Especially a time and place that I was in my life. So... I connected with it, as did apparently a whole hell of a lot of people, but it showed another side to them, another depth that you just weren't expecting to happen.
Yeah.
I completely thought you were going to go Time of Your Life. I seriously thought that's what you were pulling out. Cause I was like, oh, cool. He's going with Green Day. The complete thing of that. I was not expecting Boulevard of Broken Dreams.
No, me neither. That made me think of another one though.
I do this, you know.
So I'll do. You guys got stuff for one more round?
Yeah, I got one more.
All right. You know, who would have thought that not only the song is very different than their other shit, but who would have thought that it'd be like one of the most popular songs ever? Of course, I mean, The Black Parade by My Chemical Romance.
Okay. I gotta say, I like that. That's They actually play that Halloween Horror Nights is one of the things. I was like, is this the soundtrack that we're going with for this thing? Okay, this is how we're entering in. Cool, let's do it. So even though I've already said it, I'm just going to say, you know, I'm going to stick with that Green Day song since that's the end of it.
Yeah, okay.
You know, Time of Your Life, fucking not what people were expecting.
I see, yeah.
Unless you're, yeah, that's a great way to fucking end it, unless you're going to do Queen for a Day. That was completely different. Or I Was All By Myself. Those are like secret songs, which are fucking phenomenal. But yeah, Time of Your Life, like that's always like fucking go-to for fucking graduations or something. But that's the end for me tonight.
All right.
Absolutely. So our introduction, especially within the grunge world, during the 90s, you know, when it first kicked in, took the world by storm because up to that point, everyone was kind of sick of the, you know, the hair band thing and all those fucking power ballads and shit. So this other band hits us and their first fucking song, you know, was very hard hitting. So you could definitely feel like a little bit more of a heaviness to them. But then one of their biggest fucking singles off that first record ended up on the Crow soundtrack, and it was one that you could literally listen to 4, 5, 6 times a day and never get sick of it. I actually found that to be rather interesting because I, other than like Sabbath or any of the great heavy bands from the 80s, I would do that with. But, you know, I heard the song by Stone Temple Pilots, Big Empty, and hooked. and there's this nice, like, bluesy guitar, you know, slide going on. Mm-hmm. And dude's voice was just fucking amazing before he fucked himself into oblivion.
Right.
Yeah. But anyways, I mean, just wasted talent. The guy was fucking phenomenal.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So that's my last and final pick.
All right. All right. Well, that is it. Oh, wait. We started the round.
You did.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we're good. Yeah? Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, that'll do it for tonight. Make sure everyone tune in on Friday night for Gutter Trash Cinema. We're going to have one hell of a show.
And unfortunately, I won't be able to be there because I will be rocking out.
Yes. I mean, well, that's good, but no.
I know. I'm heartbroken. I really am. But we've got a pretty big show debuting in Akron, Ohio, our hometown. That we have not been able to play since the pandemic, because we never got a chance to. So this will be our introduction after, you know, the success that we've had and kind of coming back and throwing down in a nice intimate situation. So,
well, good luck to you, buddy.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you. It's going to be a busy 3 weeks.
Oh yeah. All right. Well, have a good night, everybody, and we will see you all soon.
Stay heavy.
Fuck you. When I'm screaming, fuck you. Made the bigger in the air, and all I wanted to hear was you screaming. Fuck you, too. Yeah, I'm running in a stratosphere in a brand new room atmosphere. I wanna go and shoot, 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 shoot to the campus clear, cause I never thought I would've made it out of here alive. From the land where the people put the evil, evil in that ride. You'll never see an equal to my kind, so blind to anything to line the lights of mind is right now. Looking for another mind to fight foul. Bringing everything that you can bring down in the ground like 150 pounds of seafoam. Looking for keyboard lugs, well, I'ma need more slugs, cause I wanna see more blood. You ain't never seen gold like us. They don't wanna make them any more like us. But I'm on tour with the paint on them. And anybody can know your little lame song. Fuck right, I'ma stay wrong. Black out with a ray gun. Looking for anybody to make up. Motherfuckers really need to wake up.
There's nothing really you can say. There's never gonna change my mind. I'm also fucked that shit today. Fuck it, I don't care. Middle fingers in the air. It's up in here, only can it's up in here. Fuck it, I don't care. Middle fingers in the air. Only can it's up in here, only can it's up in here.
Shit. I was born a son of a bitch and always talk a whole gang of shit. Even know that I wouldn't work for it. Now tell it became a pastor. The whole world reveling the wake of my dad's disaster. Had to talk to a pastor. Told me sit down, handle my shit, and try to figure out what the fuck's really the matter. Hey, none of my city, only big ass wicked is the last of victim. I'm your own person. I promise I never know peace.